necessary thing is a reality that comes with a relationship with God. The subtitle here is Knowing Jesus Knows and Can Relate Brings a Rest That Is Real. He doesn't just know, he can relate in a way that's real, and it brings a rest that's real, which is good because, of course, he is real too. And so this worked out great as an opening illustration, at least in my mind it did. Well, I guess we'll find out in the next couple minutes. But some of you know, this past week, our dog got this big, nasty, blood-sucking tick pulled from her snout. Is there anything but a nasty tick? Let's just settle that. But where we live now, there are deer that bed down. I didn't mean that. There are deer that bed down in the backyard, so Naomi had this big, nasty tick on her snout. And so what did I do when I discovered the problem that we face about trying to get the deer to not feel welcome in our backyard apart from using a shotgun? And I originally put that on the Facebook page of the Franklin Lakes News people. I thought, that's not the best way to introduce myself. So I quickly took that down. But apart from the shotgun, how can we keep these deer away from our yard? So what I did is I went to that Facebook page, and I tapped into, and I love this phrase, the collective brain trust. When you put a lot of people together, there's a lot of information you don't know that they know, things you don't have that they have, and the collective brain trust can be a very good thing. And so that's what I did. I tapped into the collective brain trust and experience of those who have been there for years through the Facebook page of the Lakes of Franklin Mills, I think it's called, the private group that there are, you know, there are many of those on Facebook. And I asked, what do you do? What can we do to alleviate this? Because I knew there were people there who knew what I was dealing with because they had already dealt with it. Deer, coyote, snapping turtles from some of the lakes. I discovered all kinds of information that I didn't know. And so, I knew that there were people who knew what I didn't know about what we could do about this. And sure enough, I got a lot of helpful feedback and encouragement. Because, and here's the key, I knew they knew what I needed to know. What in the world does that have to do with this morning's message? It sets the stage for us to be able to acknowledge and address the reality of a high priest who knows everything with which we struggle because he lived on earth and struggled too, far beyond deer and ticks. Is the reality that God came into this sin-drenched world to rescue everybody in their sin. And so he came, he lived, he experienced this fallen world. The scripture's clear, he's been tempted in every way as we are, yet he didn't sin. We'll hear that in just a second. And because of that, again, going back to the title, there's this rest that we can have that comes from knowing the high priest who knows. There is nothing that you or I are going through that A, God doesn't know about, and that B, God doesn't care about, and that C, God isn't able to address. Nothing. Which is meant to bring comfort. And one of the words we'll see at the end of this chapter is confidence. In him. In who he is and what he did. So, the theme this morning is this. Jesus is our high priest, and is truly able to sympathize with our weaknesses. That's straight from the scriptures. And the application is this. Keep coming to him as you are, aware and convinced of who he really is. Whatever it is that you need, the important, the eternal issues that only he can address, listen, he can address them. And he can equip you, he can enable you, he can inform you, he can strengthen you, he can guide you. He's promised to bring all of his children home, which means he's going to bring us through whatever goes on in this life. We can trust him. So here's the focus. I can relate. I feel your pain. Been there, done that, got the shirt. I know how you feel. Let me tell you how I got through that. What do all those statements have in common? They're expressions of empathy, not just compassion or kindness or concern, but empathy. When somebody is able to say to you, I know how you feel, and you know they know how you feel. This, they're not sharing textbook information. They're not sharing something they heard on TV or found on the internet. They're speaking from their experience of having been where you are right now. And it's those kind of people that we need in our lives. And again, what we're seeing here this morning is the ultimate one who truly empathizes, who can say, I know and I care and I understand. And he alone, in ways that only he alone can say, I can handle that. You can trust me. So when it comes to empathy, the greatest one ever is the best one for each one of us to turn to. Hebrews chapter 4 makes it clear that Jesus alone stands above the rest when it comes to providing the rest we long for based on his ability to relate to whatever it is we're going through. And that last sentence is why English is so hard to learn sometimes, because the word rest appears twice and it means two completely different things in that sentence. Let me read it again. Hebrews chapter 4 makes it clear that Jesus alone stands above the rest when it comes to providing the rest we long for based on his ability to relate to whatever it is we're going through. And again, to be able to say that he can relate to whatever it is we're going through is either a truth statement or a lie. And based on the scriptures, we know it is what? A truth statement. That empathy is what he can bring to the table in any situation in which we find ourselves. So, this morning's message, if you turn with me there to Hebrews chapter 4, we're not going to read the whole chapter. I'd encourage you to do that sometime even today. But we're going to highlight a couple of the passages in it. And we're going to start with the first few verses. The first point this morning concerning Jesus being our high priest is this. Jesus being our high priest means real rest is a reality for those who are really his. It may not be an experiential reality for you right now, but it's a reality that you can experience if you're his. So again, Jesus being our high priest means real rest is a reality for those who are really his. Underneath it says, the rest is real because it is God who grants and gives it. It's real because it's from the one who's the most real one there is. And we'll see here, he uses the word promise. Listen, Hebrews chapter 4, verses 1 through 3. Therefore, since the promise of entering his rest still stands, let us be careful that none of you be found to have fallen short of it. For we also have had the good news proclaimed to us, just as they did, but the message they heard was of no value to them because they did not share the faith of those who obeyed. As you read the rest of Hebrews, you get to the 11th chapter, which we're going to look at next week, on faith. And faith is a recurring theme here in the book of Hebrews. It's as though the promise was made, but they denied it. And a promise denied is a promise not experienced. And the benefit of what you could experience if you believe it and live it will never be known, even though the promise is true. What a tragedy that is. For we also have had the good news proclaimed to us, just as they did, but the message they heard was of no value to them because they did not share the faith of those who obeyed. Now, we who have believed enter that rest, just as God said, so I declare upon both in my anger they shall never enter my rest. And you have to read the rest of the chapter to qualify that statement. That is a very harsh statement of punishment. They refused to enter, and the punishment wasn't something that so much God had to inflict as much as it was the fact that they just never experienced it. To live with no experience of rest is his own punishment. And so I want to highlight the beginning of that third verse. Now we who have believed, past tense reality, present tense occurrence, enter that rest, just as God has said. His works have been finished since the creation of the world. That's how the third verse ends. His works have been finished since the creation of the world. So that part, that expression of the works he's accomplished, just like what Christ did on the cross when he said that word in the Greek, telestai, it in English is translated, it is finished, paid in full, done deal. The same thing with creation. It was finished when God completed it, obviously. And so there's a real rest for those who are really His. The heart of this letter of Hebrews is about encouragement and perspective. And both are extremely important, because if we don't have this eternal heavenly perspective on our earthly struggles and fears and failures and confusions and heartaches and whatever else comes with being in a fallen world, if we don't have a perspective that is real, connected to eternity, then it's hard to feel very encouraged when you like watch the news or read the newspaper or, you know, however you receive your information, because it can be so discouraging. So encouragement and perspective are meta themes throughout the book of Hebrews. It's written to believers who were experiencing persecution and hardships because of their faith in Christ. The struggles that they were facing is because they were right with God. That's what's being addressed here. Struggles that are unique only to those who are right with God. Because as soon as you get right with God, you just got wrong with the world that killed Him when He came here as one of us. So of course there's going to be struggle and all that comes in. And so I want to say this. When you're being beaten up in any way, I'm not talking, hopefully never physically, but I'm talking about being beaten up by what other people do, things that people allow, God doesn't allow, the harshness and the hardness and the heartache that can be a part of this world. Whenever you're being beaten up in any way, rest is often scarce, if not totally non-existent, right? It's kind of hard to rest when the bombs are going off around you, that kind of thing. And a reality is that the turmoil on the outside of us can find its way to the inside of us. Is that the truth or not, right? That sometimes it's hard to keep out there what's trying to get in here. And life will punch you in the gut. And people around you will confuse you and bring trial into your life just because of your relationship with them. Whatever the relationship is, family or work or even church, whatever. That the terminal on the outside finds its way in. And then what can continue to happen is we begin to live without rest in a continual state of fatigue. Right? Come on, right? That's exactly how it can be. That the more turmoil on the outside that gets on the inside causes rest to be a fleeting thing, if a non-existent thing, and then we go to bed tired, we wake up tired, and far beyond the physical. And so it's like rest. What are you talking about? Rest. I haven't had rest since I can't remember. And if that's your story or my story, part of what we have to acknowledge is the problem isn't all what's going on outside of us. You know, we have to own that. And so what he says in that first verse, since the promise of entering his rest still stands. And that's good to go on, what is this, November 15th, 2020? It'd be good to go on November 16th, 2020. And whatever is ahead and however many days we all have left, it still stands. And then it's this admonition / warning. Let us be careful that none of you be found to have fallen short of it. Because falling short of it brings an experience that God does not want us to have. A restless soul. A racing mind, an anxious heart. That's like kryptonite to rest, right? And so we have to be aware of that. The promise still stands. So if we're not experiencing this rest in our lives today, that's on us, because God doesn't lie. As silly as it may seem, and some of us here have extended family of mixed family, blended families of Asian or Oriental descent or heritage, and our dear daughter Laura became very good with chopsticks when she moved to
stop 6 at all.
So I'm first job stays. And I still haven't figured out the whatever it is. And so every now and then, if you've ever been to a Chinese restaurant or an Asian restaurant, and you think, you know what, I'm going to try. And if you don't know how to use chopsticks, you don't know how to use chopsticks. Don't kid yourself. Don't try to learn in front of everybody else. It just gets ugly. But the point I'm making with something as seemingly insignificant as chopsticks is there's no rest if you don't know how to use chopsticks and you're hungry. And you're trying to get that food in you pretty soon, and you lose all social decorum. You know? Here's the thing. Ask for silverware. You'll rest. Right? There's a rest that comes from silverware when that's what you're used to. And the point here being is when you feel like you're trying to live life at a Chinese dinner with chopsticks, the thing to do is put down the chopsticks and turn to the one who can give you the silverware. That makes sense? Why continue to live with needless anxiety? You'll enjoy the meal a whole lot more without the chopsticks if you don't know how to use them. There's a rest that comes from making the right choice. That's the point. And the right choice is to believe the promise that God has made and to enjoy the benefit of that promise in the context of the world that's not going to change around us. In Psalm 23, there's that verse right that says, in the presence of my enemies, you prepare a table before me. I bet you there weren't chopsticks. But you prepare a table before me. I'm just kidding. But to make the point that even in the presence of enemies, you can enjoy a meal. Because God is with you. And that's the whole focus of this. Our high priest is with us. He can relate to us. He has, and I'll probably say it again, he didn't just bring an offering. He was the offering. He died in our place. And so we can take rest in knowing the one who died for us, the one who grants us life, the one who loves us in a way we will never fully understand in this life, is the one who's with us. Sit down and enjoy a meal. Rest. Take your shoes off. Some of you. Take your shoes off. There's something about taking your shoes off when you realize that. Now, I'm really welcome here. Go ahead and do that. This is the rest that comes, that can be ours. So Jesus being our high priest means real rest is a reality for those who are really his. Second point this morning, Jesus being our high priest is revealed to us through the quote-unquote aliveness of God's word. If you drop down, the rest of this passage, so we get to this verse we're going to look at, is a warning about today if you hear your heart, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts. Because if you hear his voice and you harden your hearts, there will be no rest. And so he continues to unpack that. Then we get to this 12th verse, a very familiar passage for many of us, a great verse to memorize as if you're a new Christian or an old Christian, you haven't memorized it yet. Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12 says, for the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing the thoughts and intents of the heart. It speaks of the, and now I just remember that I forgot how it went in the middle there, about dividing the joints and the marrow. How about if I just read it? For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to the dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. The translation I memorized, it says it divides between the thoughts and the intentions of the heart. And so, and then verse 13, nothing in all creation is hidden from God's sight. Everything is uncovered and laid bare before the eyes of him to whom we must give an account. And so, when we say Jesus being our high priest is revealed through the aliveness of God's word, underneath it says, it's the living scriptures that reveal everything we need to know about God and life. Let me read that verse again, a little slower. For the word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. So we're not talking about a physical blade. And when it says sharper than any two-edged sword, it would seem a more fitting word in our day and age in which to describe it would be more of a scalpel than a sword or a knife. There weren't scalpels back then. Nobody was doing surgery back then. And one blade will kill you. One blade will cut you and kill you. Another blade will cut you and heal you. And they both cause blood to flow. So it's just mind-boggling. But the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. And the sharpness of a scalpel, it is absolutely amazing. The clean cut, the lack of trauma around the incision, as versus a blade that just tears everything apart. And when it says that it divides the thoughts and the attitudes, or the thoughts and the intents of the heart, this is where God's word gets to the why behind the what, the motive behind the action. And that's where a lot of us want to say, I'm sorry, you're not welcome in that part of my life. We don't talk about that. Don't even ask. But God isn't asking. What he's doing is he's offering. You need surgery. I can do that. And he does that through his word. Again, it's his word, his living word. And this passage is one of the clearest explanations. I've kind of alluded to this already. This passage is one of the clearest explanations for why it is so many people avoid the Bible. It can feel like going to a doctor who needs to cause pain to find the pain source, which can be no fun in and of itself. But the reason for all that is to alleviate the pain and get to the cure. This is going to hurt for a while and you're going to be healed, or this is going to ache and you're going to be in pain for the rest of your life. And so that's why some of us don't want to read the Bible. Another passage in James says it's like a mirror. You want to see you got a big old piece of broccoli in your teeth? You know? Yes, you do. You want to get it out. And the same thing with this, the word of God that is sharper than any two-edged sword. It's going to cut to heal, not cut to kill. Ironically, it'll kill what's killing you when it cuts to heal. Right? It's just, again, mind-blowing when you think of this. To the thoughts and the attitudes, to the thoughts and intents of the heart. Oh no, we might say. You mean the stuff that really matters that only God can see? Yep. Yep. Because when he sees it, he's not going to shame you. He's not going to guilt you. You've already got guilt, don't you? You've got a conscience. He's going to do what needs to be done with the cutting of his word. Not just to touch your heart, but at times to cut your heart. Not the physical one. You know. And so with that comes just the understanding that when we engage with God through his word and we find his word causing a cut that really does hurt, what we need to do is just embrace the healing that's going to come from his word making that distinction. The thoughts and the intents of the heart. And part of the significance of this is understanding that until the why behind the what gets identified, isolated, and dealt with, then the whatever change may come remains primarily cosmetic and not complete. You can put makeup or you can put stuff over a wound or something, but eventually it's going to fester. It's going to be infected. Someone came across it earlier this week. If we don't acknowledge and address our childhood trauma, our adult relationships will expose it. That if we don't deal with the why behind the what, then we're going to be dealing with the what. It will never be fully resolved. You'll never be able to put it behind you until you get to the heart of the matter, which is our good friend David Brony says is the matter of the heart. So until the why behind the what gets identified, isolated, and dealt with, whatever change may come remains primarily cosmetic and not complete. We need to get to the root, and God's living word can expose and address what's killing us. An intentional play on words. God's living word can expose and address what's killing us. Because his word is sharper than a two-edged sword. And it's meant to heal, not harm. Though there will be pain involved. Last but not least, Jesus being our high priest is meant to be celebrated and embraced, knowing there's nothing about our struggles that he doesn't know. Let me say that again. This is meant to be celebrated and embraced, Jesus being our high priest, because there's nothing about our struggles He already knew that. He saw us do it. Didn't stop loving us, did he? I'm not saying being sloppy about sin or minimizing sin's ugliness and destruction. But this is we're talking about a high priest who can empathize, whose heart is love. Just for the sake of context, I do want to, before we read this last passage, would you just jump with me to the beginning of the fifth chapter, even though I didn't reference it here, and just listen to these words, because, again, we're the ones around the 1500s who put the chapters and the verses in the scriptures to make it more accessible. This was a letter that was written to these believers who were being persecuted. Every high priest is selected from among the people and is appointed to represent the people in matters related to God, to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. That's a key verse to understanding this whole thing. Because he's writing to Jewish people who understand high priests, and they have high priests. Zacharias was a priest, and he happened to get the number on the announcement of the birth of John. And anyway, but every high priest is selected from among the people. This is key, and is appointed to represent the people in matters related to God. That's what a high priest does. That's why this high priest we're talking about, Jesus himself, who also is God, is so very important. And then look at the rest of it. To offer gifts and sacrifices for sin. What were the gifts and sacrifices Jesus offered for sins? Himself. He was the gift. He was the sacrifice. And so when we understand that Jesus being our high priest is meant to be celebrated and embraced, knowing there's nothing about our struggles he doesn't know about, then we can acknowledge what it says underneath that. God can look you in the eyes and say to your heart, I know and I care. Now rest. You can't forgive yourself. You can't cleanse yourself. I can't. I'm your high priest. And when we understand that he can do that, we turn to before that, and then we receive that, the end of all that is rest. Forget the election. Forget the pandemic. Can't completely, I get that. But put them in their proper perspective. 100 years from now, neither is going to mean a stinking thing. Right now, right here, you, yes, you, can rest in your heart, in your head. Rest. Going back to that first verse, the promise of entering his rest still stands. And it doesn't say, unless you live in the United States in 2020 and there's an election. It doesn't say that. It doesn't say that anywhere in the world. And I'm not, again, I'm laughing so I don't cry. There's nothing funny about what's going on in this election. There's nothing funny about this pandemic. But there is something joyful about knowing that in the middle of it, or wherever you're at, whatever is or isn't going on in your life, God is extending this offer of rest. And it takes you to leave it. And it really is where that choice is ours. This is what this chapter leads to and ends with. We have a high priest who is able to empathize with our weakness because he was tempted in every way just as we are and have been. This one never sinned and didn't just bring, but was the sacrifice for our sins. Let us read that passage at the end of Hebrews 4, verses 14 through 16. Therefore, since we have a great high priest who has ascended into heaven, Jesus, the Son of God, make no mistake, it can't be any more clear than that. Your high priest is Jesus, who is the Son of God. Let us hold firmly to the faith we profess, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who has been tempted in every way, just as we are, yet did not sin. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. He's been tempted in every way just as we are. with the specifics we've been tempted with? No, he wasn't alive in this time, in this culture. But the core of them, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the boastful pride of life, when you go back to, and I still can't believe, you know, boom, here Jesus is baptized in the Jordan River. Boom, there's the Judean wilderness where he spent 40 days and 40 nights. If you ever go to Israel, you'll see it. He's baptized, the Holy Spirit descends on him as a dove, the same Holy Spirit forces him into the wilderness, and he's tempted for 40 days and 40 nights. And the last recording, the recording of that temptation about the stones and the bread and the worship, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the boastful pride of life. Those are the categories in which everything we've wrestled with concerning sin find their place. And Jesus took them all full force from Satan himself. And who won and who lost? He's been tempted in every way just as we are. Yet he did not sin. And then the entirety of his earthly ministry, you don't think Satan had been dogging him? Of course he was. And continued to tempt him. And he continued to never sin. So he would go to that cross, spotless, a perfect lamb to be sacrificed. Spotless. Exactly no sin. And he's our high priest. So, we celebrate and embrace that, knowing that to be true. And again, don't miss verse 16. We'll end with this. Let us then approach I didn't read this yet, did I? I stopped right before that. The 16th verse. Let us then approach God's throne of grace with, say it,
confidence.
So that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time. Once in my life, I had an all-access backstage pass at Blossom, for an event at Blossom. And basically what this is saying, this throne of grace, is you have an all-access pass, and you can come to the place of places to obtain help in your time of need. Apart from an all-access pass, the only place you can go is out front. You can't be where everything's happening. On the stage, the dressing rooms, backstage, all that stuff. It's a whole other world back there. And this is a whole other world at the throne of grace. You don't have to just stand back and look at the throne of grace. But he's saying, come on. Because at this throne of grace, with the one who's the gracious one there, here's what you need. He'll give you the mercy, the grace, the help, the strength that you need. And again, the end result of all that is a rest that only comes from the one who has fought the fight and already won the war. And there's a rest that is real. So back to the beginning here. I told you about tapping into the brain trust where we just moved to in this homeowners association. And the information that was there that I didn't have until I tapped into that brain trust. Far beyond the brain trust is an all-sufficient high priest who will never fail you. He has never failed you. He's allowed things that you think he's failed you. But we will see on that final day he's never failed us. Not one of us, not once. This great high priest who can relate to what it is we're going through and get to the heart of the matter of what the struggle is. We need his word for that. The scriptures for teaching, rebuking, and correcting all that they exist for. Because our lives, in a similar way, even though you don't think about it, but now I got, you know, that thing, the scar I have that helps you stay in the lane keep assist system is what it's called. You still better keep your hands on the wheels. But this lane keep assist system will, with this little camera that then interacts with the computer, keeps you in the middle of the lane if there's a sideline and another line. And the majority of driving is course correction. The majority of driving is course correction. That's the majority of living too, right? Course correction. And the more we stay right with God and the closer we are to God, it's like this. And the longer we don't stay with God, and we're not aware of things, pretty soon you may start veering off. It's like this, or like this, you know. But if you're driving right, it's constant course correction. And this high priest who leads us keeps us in that place. And there is, again, the big word this morning is rest. There is rest that is real. A rest that helps us understand, I don't need to stay up all night worrying about this. I struggle not to, but I don't need to. He's got the whole world. Right? You and me, brother. You and me, sister. And he's the one who calmed the sea. You don't think he can calm your heart? Of course he can. And then there's a rest that comes from that. That is a gift from him himself. So, Jesus being our high priest means real rest is a reality for those who are really his. Jesus being our high priest is revealed to us through the aliveness of God's word. And Jesus being our high priest is meant to be celebrated and embraced, knowing there's nothing about our struggles that he doesn't know. So here are the making it real questions. Have you ever truly experienced the rest described here? Somebody just said yes loud enough for me to hear. I hope many of you can say yes in your heart right now. And if the truth is you're saying, I'm not sure I ever have, we're going to be praying about that. Have you ever experienced, truly experienced, the rest described here? The Sabbath rest. Where basically God intentionally says, rest. Not like telling a dog to sit. But lovingly, he's telling us, rest. And he loves us enough that if we don't do that long enough, he'll make us rest. I've heard story after story of that. I've had some experiences myself. You're not going to rest? Okay. Okay. You are now. And it's because he loves us. The second question is, can you see why reading the Bible sometimes stings severely? Because it shows us what's wrong with us, because there's nothing wrong with it and there's nothing wrong with him. But there is still stuff that's wrong with us. And far beyond just outside behaviors, that verse says the thoughts and intents or the attitudes of the heart. Oh, now we got to deal with attitudes. Yes, because it's the attitudes that cause the good or bad behavior. So taking responsibility for that. And then the last question is, in what specific ways are you grateful for this overwhelming truth that we have a high priest who can relate to us? A high priest who never sinned and became the sacrifice itself. And I don't say this lightly, but I say this to make the point because it's the truth. He's the best friend you will ever have. He's the best friend forever. He's the only true BFF. He's the only one who's your best friend forever. And nobody else can fulfill that. The action step is to write down the three top things with which you're struggling today. Ah, that sentence isn't right there, is it? But that is right. Write down the three top things with which you're struggling today. Then do with them what God says to do here in Hebrews 4:14-16. Go to the throne of grace. Bring them there. I guarantee you, part of the transaction that happens there is you will be encouraged to leave them there with him. Let him handle them. Doesn't mean you're not still responsible for your part in whatever is ahead in rectifying whatever it is you're struggling with, but it is to say, the part of it that keeps you awake at night, the part of it that, you know, messes with your blood pressure and anything else in your life? No. Whatever those things are that are messing with you, bring them to him. And then let him lead you and guide you as far as how you can deal with them in a redemptive way so that they don't have power over you. They don't control your life. They don't redirect your life. Again, needlessly. So as we close here this morning, would you pray with me and let's ask God as we do in one way or another every week to make this real. That's why we're calling it making it real questions. How do we take what we've heard and how do we turn to you, God, and have you show us how to apply it to our life? It's one thing to read the instruction manual. It's another thing to follow the instruction. And then he gives us the grace to follow the instructions, to do what he says, knowing it's because he cares for us. So let's pray together and ask him to to do what only He can do. Father in heaven, we bow to You. We thank You for the grace that You keep giving us to keep coming together in worship, trust, and in Your power and love. We pray for the strength we need to know and do Your will in these days of confused situations, days of desperation, but also days of opportunity and change. Sometimes we make changes, sometimes the changes make us. We pray for the grace to weather these storms that we find ourselves in. Thank You for sheltering the storm, that's You. Help us to see and to know Jesus for the high priest He truly is, the one who can truly and totally relate to us in our humanity. Thank You for the confidence we can have in Him and the confidence with which we can approach the throne of grace, not because of who we are, but because of whose we are. And we can come boldly with confidence to the place where the real healing happens. Help us to do that, God, in ways we never have before. We do continue to pray for the results of an election that took place 12 days ago now. May what's right be what takes place in just the right time and just the right way, whatever that is. We do pray for Your kingdom to come and Your will to be done in every way possible, knowing that means we will be part of how it is You answer that prayer for Your kingdom to come and Your will to be done. Whenever we see evidence of the lack of Your kingdom here on earth, help us to move toward the people and the situation where Your kingdom needs to be expressed. And help us to do that with Your power and Your grace, Your kindness and love, Your authority and Your peace. And finally, God, help us not waste our lives on lesser things. May we value what matters most and lasts forever. And we pray as we always pray in Jesus' name for the glory of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And the benediction this morning is this: now go as peace people who know the peace of God through the God of peace, Jesus Himself, the